shall come to the light. Oh, it's good to be back here. I have, what am I wearing on my neck, around my neck?
A cross.
A cross. What does it mean? What does it mean?
Cardinal signs.
Cardinal signs, all right. What are the cardinal signs?
North, south, east, west.
North, south, east, and west, all right. What else does it mean?
Aries, Cancer, Libra, and Capricorn.
All right, Aries, Cancer, Leo, and Capricorn are the what?
Those are the cardinal signs of the zodiac.
All right. Have they always been? He's coming?
Yeah, it's very soon.
Oh, good. Has it always been that way?
Yes.
Has it always been? Has Aries, Cancer, Libra, and Capricorn has been, always been the cardinal points?
Yes.
Cardinal points, for those who do not know, are the points that ushers in a new season. Aries, when the sun is in Aries, it's ushered in spring. When the sun is in enters Cancer, it ushers in summer. When the sun is enters Libra, it ushers in fall, autumn. When the sun enters Capricorn, it ushers in winter. That's what I gotta explain, because I can't assume. Can't assume. That people know, I know better not to do that. Like you said, cardinal signs, cardinal points, you know, that make the old people hate it. All right? No, you guys are fine. It's my job to do that. All right? What else? All right, so I asked the question. Has it always been, have those four signs ushered in the four seasons?
Yes.
You said yes. Who said yes? Why yes?
Because it's always been summer, spring, winter, and fall.
Yes, but has it always been where Aries has ushered in the spring? Has that always been thousands of years? So you say that it's fixed. That those four points, cardinal points, Aries, today is Aries, Cancer, Libra, and Capricorn. Are you saying they're fixed?
Yes.
I mean, they went for $10, $20, $40, $50, $100 years.
Yes.
All right. Why you say yes?
Because I would say because a tree will always produce a seed that produces that same tree. So since the cycles have been going on since time immemorial, how could it possibly change?
Now you said, stop there. You said cycles.
Yes.
You said cycles.
Yes.
All right. So we talk about, the seasonal cycle,
Yes.
We have what's called the precession of the equinoxes. What causes the precession of the equinoxes is the axial tilt of the earth and the wobble of the earth. That causes the precession of the equinoxes. All right? And those signs aren't fixed. Every 2,152 years, the vernal equinox moves 30 degrees in retrogression. So it hasn't always been Aries, Cancer, Libra, and Capricorn. Because you had what's called the precession of the equinoxes. So what was it? What was the position 2,000 years ago? What were the positions of the seasons? The signs 2,000 years ago. You know it's Aries now. What was it 2,000 years ago?
Sagittarius.
Pisces.
I think Taurus.
It's Aries now. Since someone says Pisces, all you going, the procession goes in retrogression.
Taurus?
We're going backwards. Counterclockwise, retrogression. So it's not Aries, Taurus. All right, so what was it?
Pisces.
Well, what's in retrogression now? In retrogression. What's before?
Pisces. Before Aries?
Yes, in retrogression.
Pisces.
Taurus. Retrogression. Taurus, Aries, Pisces. We're going backwards. Yeah, so if you're talking retrogression, Taurus is. It moved from Taurus to Aries.
Counterclockwise,
they move from Taurus to Aries. Right, you're doing clockwise. That's what I'm saying. If you talk about the precession of the equinoxes, it's a retrograde motion, backward motion. All right? So Taurus, Aries. Not Aries, Taurus. Taurus, Aries. Now, what about, now, since y'all understand it, now, what about spring? What about summer?
Gemini.
Remember retrogression now. Retrogression.
Leo.
Cancer. Alright? What about all? You know it's Libra now.
Virgo? No, not Virgo. Scorpio.
Scorpio, Libra, Virgo. Alright? Scorpio, Libra, Virgo, Leo, Gemini. Let's go backwards. All right, now what about winter? We know it's Capricorn today.
Aquarius.
All right. Aquarius, Capricorn. All right. Sagittarius, Scorpio, Libra. Just go backwards. That's all. You just go backwards. Yes, Aquarius. Remember, it's making its way backwards. Aquarius, then Capricorn. All right, so to get it, you know that it, because you're doing retrogression. So you know the jump wasn't from Sagittarius to Capricorn, because that's not retrogression. Sagittarius to Capricorn is not retrogression. What's the retrogression?
Scorpio.
It would be what?
Scorpio.
Aquarius, Capricorn, Sagittarius, Scorpio, Libra, Virgo, Leo, Gemini. Alright, that's retrogression. Alright? So that's the precession. Now the precession of equinoxes. Our ancestors taught this thousands of years ago, and this knowledge is very important. It has been preserved. The Europeans have preserved this in their orders. A new age brings about a huge shift in climate. Huge flooding. Climate changes, but there's no need to panic. Well, we're gonna panic because we lack knowledge. So of course we're gonna panic because we lack knowledge. But a society that has knowledge of this, there's no need to panic because you can predict things, you know, hundreds of years in advance. Since the mass of the people, but this knowledge is known by those who are in control. All right, it's not lost knowledge. The masses of people don't have it. The masses of people do not have this knowledge. Because the masses of people doesn't have it now doesn't mean it's lost. Because the masses of people aren't movers and shakers. They're not, you know. Because you don't need just to, if you had those movers and shakers know it, because they're the ones that are going to be moving hundreds of thousands of people. You know, California can go underwater in 100 years. Well, the mass of the people ain't gonna be moving
you know, that's going to be done by those who control. They're going to relocate 100,000 or, you know, 400,000 people out of California. Yeah, so precession of equinoxes. Now, the night orders use the eight-pointed star, all of them. They use eight-pointed star, eight-pointed cross. They'll have the 4 points, and they'll have like a they'll have 4 points. And then I'll have a point within on each section of the cross, eight-pointed cross. And what is that eight-pointed cross? Is symbolic of the precessional equinoxes. What occurs? We have the Earth cross, the one you see every day on churches, the one I'm wearing around my neck, the one you see on people's cars. People have hats, t-shirts, jackets, pens, on church buildings. Y'all see this all your life. Alright, that's the Earth cross. Alright? That's the Earth cross. That's your four seasons. Alright? Then you have your galactic cross. So you have the Earth cross, you have the celestial equator, and the ecliptic. The galactic cross, you have the galaxy, the galactic equator. So when the galactic equator and the ecliptic intersects, that occurs every 25,920 years. So when you see it, when you see your stuff, the Knight Orders wear Knights Templar, Knights Malta, Knights of Calatrava, Knights of Order of Christ, those orders. They all have the 8-pointed cross.
How many years?
It's 25,920 years. That's not their stuff. Alright? It's not, you can't wear that, that's not their stuff. I'm explaining to you what it is. It has a meaning. It's not a mere symbol. It has a meaning. It has an astronomical meaning. So, also the Knights Templar uses the resistance of the cross at a 23.5 degree angle. You see the Knights Templar, the cross that's tilted within a crown. You see some churches have it. All right? You'll see churches to use that too. All right? Well, that represents the precession of the equinoxes. But that's the axial tilt. That cross is tilted at a 23.5 degree angle. This is your stuff. This is your stuff. And once I begin, back in 2008, 9, I didn't know any of this. I had 100 symbols, didn't know the meaning of them. Give me that same 100 symbols, I can bring down each one of them. Give me 500 symbols, I can bring down all of them. I didn't know, I'm serious. And what I recognize is that each order has a piece of the puzzle. It's a big puzzle. That's been fractured off. So now the statue, the Egyptian statue with the cross arms, the Confederate flag, that's the Galactic cross. Europeans are scaring you with your own stuff. And laughing behind your back. Scaring you with your own stuff.
Don't blame me. They're gonna go back to slavery. That Confederate flag. That represents slavery. No, it doesn't.
They took your stuff.
All right? The galactic cross. Right? And you're saying, yeah. See, the ones who had that flag with that cross, that X on it, you know, they were pro-slavery. They took your stuff. I mean, they had no stuff. What stuff they had? What English culture? I don't know English cultures. What French culture? I don't know French culture. Dutch culture? I don't know that either. Portuguese culture? I don't know that either. I know what they're calling it, because their culture bends. I know they call it English culture. I know that. I know they call it English culture. I know. You know, we say, well, so we go to England, so we can immerse ourselves in English culture. Now, you can go over there in the Moorish land, but you're not going to be immersing yourself in the English culture because it doesn't exist. The Moors ruled Europe, not Spain, not only Spain. Moors didn't just rule Spain. Moors did not only rule Spain, Europe, Germany, Portugal, France, Sicily, England, Russia, Ireland, Scotland. Can I keep going on? Spain. Alright? So, what English culture, Portuguese culture, French culture? What was going on before the Moors? What was Roderick doing? King Roderick? In the late 600s. Late 600s, he was despotic. King Roderick of the Visigoths, King of the Visigoths. He was despotic. The Visigoths called on the Moors. Moors did not, they said, yeah, the Moors invaded. No. Anyone who teaches that, ask them what was the condition before the Moors. That's all, let's ask them. That's how you want to shut them down? That's how you shut them down. Any scholar who says, who teaches that the Moors conquered Spain. Ask them this, what was the condition before the Moors? Before the Moors, what was the condition? And what did the Moors do 800 years while they're there? They would die of diseases, tens of thousands, didn't take baths, then bury their dead. Is that a conquering, or is that more saving Europe? The Moors conquered Europe, the Moors saved Europe. Thank you. Daddy, you represent? Sales, scholar, good for the gentleman, you represent? Yeah, Moors conquered Europe! Moors conquered Spain! No, Moors saved Spain. Europe. They were the Dark Ages. Dark Ages means not illiteracy. High rate of illiteracy. High rate of diseases. So if it wasn't for us, what would it be today? They're standing on your shoulders. They're standing on your shoulders and dissing you. They're arrogant. Lying to you so that they did it themselves. Yeah, you see textbooks. Yeah, Renaissance. You see all these pictures of you. You don't see no pictures of us in there. You see all pictures of Europeans in the textbooks. That's a lie. What was it like before the Moors? All right, there's a three volume book. And then we
got new people here. You haven't heard me. There's a three volumes, The History of the Moorish Empire in Europe by S.P. Scott. Each book, each volume is over 600 pages. That's a life's work. Very comprehensive. Very comprehensive. The Moorish Empire in Europe. And he chronicles the Moorish dynasty, the four Moorish dynasties that ruled. Remember, he didn't say the title's not the Moorish Empire in Spain, Moorish Empire in Europe. Moorish Europe. So not just like when you have African scholars who talk about Moors in Spain, the Moors in Europe, they misrepresent it. The African scholars don't just merely talk about what the African scholars and how they present it, like Edward Scobie and Nokobashi and them. They'll present it as down the Moors that the Moors were quote unquote slaves, and the Europeans, and then the Europeans, you know, feed them, and they now accepted them as part of the nobility, and you know, Moors contribute. No. Moors ruled. That's totally different. It's totally different than, yeah, they contribute paintings and, you know, sculpture. No, Moors ruled. We're talking about four Moorish dynasties, Moorish kings, caliphs, emirs, rulership. Why don't the African scholars mention that? They talk about this other stuff. Why don't they rule? Ruled Europe. No, don't just say contribution. Ruled. Use the word ruled Europe. S.P. Scott. Even is the title of his book. The Moorish Empire in Europe. The title was impactful. That title alone is impactful. Why? Because the title gives you what? The proper presentation on how to look at it. That's why that title is impactful. Moors in Europe. Moors in Europe. What does that mean? Moors in Europe. Oh, all right. See, now you got it. But we got to talk rulership. Not the contribution, you know. Yeah, see, the Europeans accepted the Moors, and you know, and then to the Moors married into the European families, and you know, Moors contributed arts, and no. Moors built castles, mosques, cathedrals, libraries, paved roads, streetlights, surgery to thesis. The thesis on eye surgery, plant classification, botany, farming. Big on hygiene, you must remember, the Europeans did not bathe. So we introduced hygiene to them. Over 30 medical treatises. Volumes. Or medical treatises, eye surgery, classification of plants, botany, which is botany. But they lie and say colonnades did that. Yes, you colonnades. You remember in the school, they lied to the school and say, well, hey, colonnades, you know, in the 1750s, you know, he classified the plants, lie. They translated books, medical books, trigonometry, architectural books, botany, horticulture, from Arabic to Latin.
Then invite Jack. Europeans went to more schools. Poor Europeans, we made education affordable to poor, dirt poor Europeans. And they didn't get no inner city crap that they get into debt. Our people get, our children get into debt. They didn't get that. They got high level, pristine education. Learn how to read Arabic, write Arabic. That's how the Europeans rolled up. We spurred the Protestant movement. Not no dog on Martin Luther. They lying again. We spurred the Protestant. Because what spurred the Protestant movement? What's the key? Remember, we're talking about a high rate of illiteracy. And only those who could read were the nobility and clergy. So what we did was, through paper mill, until in that trade with China, we were able to produce a high level of literature. We pretty much made Europe literate. We made that which was nations that were illiterate, we made it literate. It's almost like we rose the Europeans up. I'm serious. I'm serious. Europeans didn't do that on their own. That's a lie. They're lying to you. They lying to you on the textbooks. They're lying. They didn't do that on their own. They was in the textbooks. They said that they did that on their own. Europeans didn't do that on their own. They was dying of diseases. They kept, they created illiteracy. Like I said, only the clergy and nobility could read. The masses of people every day, what I'm saying is, now we know that there's a higher literacy rate. But what exists today you can't even touch back then. Some of our people, now you got some Europeans in us, right? Who are poor readers. What I'm saying is, they are way better than what the Europeans were. They didn't read at all. And you say, well, our children in the inner city, they can't read. What I'm saying to you, our children who are poor, poor, poor readers were more illiterate than them. They didn't read at all. Someone who reads like this. What is the European? They were better readers than them. I'm just trying to give an example. I'm saying they didn't read at all. They didn't touch books. They didn't touch books. We changed that. We did that. So now, of course, you're going to spur thinking. Can you teach the people how to read? Now they, first time in their life, picking up a book. They never seen a book before in their life. They're 50 years old. Like that. You know, but now they can, they're going to start what? Challenging things. That spurred the Protestant movement. We're the key to that. See what they, and they, see what they, not put in the schools. We don't even know who we are. Maybe you, and I'm upset. Why did I do that? Just, back to say, there's no English culture. There's no French culture. There's no Irish culture. There's no Scottish culture. There's no Dutch culture. It doesn't exist. So if you were there today, and you call me on your phone, yeah, Abdullah, I'm in the Netherlands. I came here to soak up this Dutch culture. I already know you don't even know what you're talking about. Yeah, I'm in Germany. Yeah, I came here to immerse myself in German culture. I know you don't know what you're talking about. You don't know. And if you walk around saying that, and Europeans who know, gonna laugh behind your back. How you gonna talk about this if you go into German culture? You go to Germany, you see all these European coats of arms looking like you. Doorknobs, I mean, you know, banners, all throughout Germany. The patron saint of an entire country is darker than me. Wesley Snipes, the patron saint of an entire country look like Wesley Snipes. No, I'm serious. St. Louis, lived in the 1100s. He's the patron saint of the entire country, St. Louis. And you go there to talk about some Dutch, go to Germany talk about some German culture. You lost your mind. You smoked in the head talking about some German culture. You go to Germany and there's some German culture. You lost your mind. You smoked in the head. You better be going there talking about Moorish culture. You know what I mean? You be talking like that. You ain't no German nothing. You don't make no German come out your mouth nothing. All right, but I'm doing y'all is giving y'all a way how to look at this. Because we don't know who we are. All right, any questions, criticism? I don't know what to talk about. Comments? Questions? I'll do that, I'll stop. And I learned to do that though. I've been teaching adults for years. Learn not to talk for 3 or 4 hours without stopping and see if there's questions or comments. And there's usually it. See? I've been doing this all the time, I don't know what I'm talking about. All right? And that's why I'll ask maybe 2 or 3 times. Why do you ask once? I'll ask once, I know that. All right, yes.
When is the next crossing of the Earth cross and the galaxy cross?
The galactic
cross. And what happens when it crosses?
Well, that occurs every 25. I don't know the exact time when that is going to occur again.
Okay.
All right? Because what it does, it completes the cycle. Because you have what's called the great year. The great year is 25,920 years. That means it's gone through all 12 precessions.
Okay.
All right, that's the great year.
Okay.
And then the great year is broken down into what's called 4 great seasons, 6,480 years. 6,480 years plus 6,480 years plus 6,400 years, it's called the 4 great seasons.
Okay.
All right, so the 25,920 years divided by 4, all right, that gives you your 4 great seasons. And today we have Leo, Taurus, Leo, Taurus, Leo, Scorpio, and Aquarius. Those are the 4 points of the galactic cross. Taurus, Leo, Scorpio, Aquarius are the 4 points of the galactic cross. The Royal Arc Masons, and their banner have a bull, a lion, they'll have a man, Taurus, or Aquarius, for example. They don't have an eagle, because it would actually use the Scorpio would actually use as an eagle. Scorpio. That's in the banner.
Okay.
That's in the banner of the Royal Arc Mason. Now, when I went for the first time to the George Boston Masada National Memorial Exam in 2005, I had no clue what it was. I saw it and took pictures.
I looked at the pictures over and over again. Then you go, wait a minute. I do now. All right? So that's it. You have your birth cross, Aries, Cancer, Libra, Capricorn, Galactic cross, Leo, Taurus, Leo, Scorpio, Aquarius. That's your galactic cross. All right? And they intersect every 25,920 years. And you see this, right before the Archmasons, you see it. It's right in front of your face. You see the 20 cross and all night boys use, right in front of your face. You'll see the tilted cross. You'll also see pictures of the image that they falsely call Jesus, European. Now, to study the gematria, study the gematria. Don't throw a picture away. Study the gematria. Study the, you'll see that the neck is tilted. That's a measurement. Because someone who knows gematria, let me explain gematria. Or canonical numbers.
Spell it.
G-E-M-A-T-R-I. I'm explaining. Or the canon law. Canon law or canonical numbers. It's encoding. You're encoding the measurements of the planet. The measurements of the circumference, radius, arc, diameter of the planets, the distance of the planets from each other. All right? That knowledge is included in the measurement of statues, in the measurement of the human body, in the layout of cities called metrology, layout of cities. The measurement of the layout of cities means that it was arbitrarily done. So someone who knows canon law, what I'm talking about now, an artist who knows canon law, they don't just pick up a brush and just draw it. No. They're using measurements. Because they're encoding, let's say you want to encode the measurement of Saturn in your artwork. Circumference, radius, diameter, arc, is distance from Earth, is distance from the Sun. So you're encoding with your measurements, you know, in the artwork. That's called canon law. Alright? It's called canon law, or canonical numbers. Gematria. All right? This is ancient knowledge. This is ancient. So that compass and square, I'm breaking this stuff down. That compass and square with that G is geometry. Earth measurement. So this knowledge has been preserved in canonical numbers. God, that's a number. Each number is a letter. 1 to 9, 10 to 90, 100 to 900. You have Hebrew, or what they call Hebrew, which is Chaldean, Greek, Latin. All right, so you have A, that's 1, B, 2, C, 3, D, 4. And then you go A, B, C, D, E, F, I, G, 6, A, B, C, D, E, F, F, G, 7. Right? Then H, I, 9, J, 10, and go 10 to 90, 90 to 100, 90 to 900. So God, that's a number. That's what? 7. Then you have your L. Your D is what? 4. All right, it's a number. And that number is a product of a measurement, of an equation. And it'll give you maybe the radius of Saturn, or circumference, a diameter, or arc.
or its distance from earth. Alright? That's what it is. Allah, number. Jesus, number. Matthew, number. Luke, John, number. Christ, number. Gee, those are numbers. Those are numbers. That's called canonical law. Canon law. The laws of nature, nature's God. Now I'm explaining the Declaration of Independence. This is our stuff, y'all. In the Declaration of Independence, you have the phrase, law of nature, alright, and nature's God. That's what I'm explaining. Laws of nature and nature's God. That's the law. The law is laws of nature, and that's the law. That's the law. Now you can go, then you're going to build some society. If that ain't your base, it's coming down. If that's not your base, I don't care what you write. Your base is that, because that's the law. I don't care what you write. If it ain't in harmony with that, it's coming down. You can have a belief and all that, and I don't mean nothing. You can't fool Mother Nature. Laws of nature and nature's God. If you have a society, that's your base. That's why that's in the Declaration of Independence. Why do you think the Europeans use the compass and square? That's your stuff. That's your stuff. Canonical law. Or canon law. That's your stuff. Laws of nature, nature's God. So that's the European thing. The European back behind your back. Big dummies. Don't even know their own stuff. Big dummies. Don't even know their own stuff. That's the European thing. I'm Afrocentric.
I don't deal with that European stuff.
Big dummies. Don't even know their own stuff. You know their own stuff. What European stuff? I don't know French, English. I don't know that. I'm not disrespectful. I'm claiming who we are. I don't know that. They stole your stuff. They put English, French, and Scottish, and Dutch, and Portuguese, and culture. It's poor. Poor. Any questions, criticism, comments? I don't know what I'm talking about. Yes.
A lot of Alvin Pike stuff talks about this stuff too.
Thank you, bro.
Thank you. Or Moors and Dogma, if anybody's
interested. Yeah, that's Alvin Pike, Moors and Dogma. And also, Alvin Pike mentions what? What I'm wearing around my neck. And Moors and Dogma, talk about
it. Yeah, he talks about all that.
And Moors and Dogma, what's Alvin Pike said about what I'm wearing around my neck? The towel? What? Egyptian?
The Egyptian, the Greeks, everybody, they all got
India?
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah.
Does Alvin Pike, European, does he say this is European?
No.
When I wear my neck. Does Alvin Pike say this is European when I wear my neck?
Not at all. He tells you exactly what they
think. He sure does. More than all. Alvin Pike. Confederate. Alvin Pike. You got a statue of him. More than all, he sure does. Yeah, see, Abdullah got that stuff, that European stuff around his neck. Mm-hmm. And Alvin Pike doesn't even say his European on it. He sure doesn't. And what did he say it was? Instrument foot? Measuring what?
The Nile.
Bam! The flood of the Nile. Yes, he does. Alvin Pike says that. Yes, he does. Or more than all. He sure does. Yeah, Moors, that's the name of the book. Moors and Dogma, that's the name of the book. I would like. He breaks stuff down in there, bro. Yes, he does.
And he reads, though, so you gotta stick with it.
Yes, it's a lot, bro. It's a lot. But it's some good stuff in there, bro. Yeah, no doubt. I recommend that book, Moors and Dogma. Yes. Shoot. But he drops some. And tell you what, his book pales Like all those Freemasonry books you see in these bookstores,
that stuff is trash.
Get Moors and Dogma, man. Man, please. Get Moors and Dogma. Get All Ages. The Manny P. Hall. The one you mentioned him. Manny P. Hall. Seeks to teach all ages. Didn't you say you mentioned
some of the Adam Pike?
Adam Pike. I'm right there. Yeah, you mentioned Adam Pike. Well, there's Manny P. Hall, too. He's good. Seeks to teach all ages. Yes, he's teaching all. That's a good book. Yes, yes. Yes, brother.
I just wanted to see if you could go back to that.
Yes.
Hiding code in words. Is that canonical law?
Canon law. Each. This is a number.
You know, what's the all? Give me all. A, B, C, D, E, 15.
How much?
15.
15?
No, 16.
All right, no. All right, no. I'm sorry, I didn't. It's 1 to 9, 10 to 90, 10, 20, 30, 40. It's not 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16.
60.
60. Oh, thank you.
60.
That's
16.
60. I'm sorry, 60. Thank you. 60. All right, yeah. So that's, there you go. 7,640. Thank you. 60.
And he's work. He's work out.
Yeah, that's different. God equals 7,740. It's a number. See, those who know, they're seeing numbers. I guess, as you know, we're looking at etymology, but I'm not dealing with etymology right now. I'm dealing with canonicals. I'm not breaking down the meaning, God, divine, from whom, the Sanskrit. I'm not doing that. But I'm talking about numbers. This is a number. It's a number. It's 7,604. It's a number. You're looking at a system of encoding. Now, let's explain it. 1491. I think it's November 25th, 1491. Bolderdale was beheaded. The last, who's Bolderdale? Who's Bolderdale? Who is Bolderdale? B-O-A-B-D-I-L. Bolderdale. Who's Bolderdale? Who's Bolderdale? Who was he? Thank you. Come on, he got it.
The last Moorish king.
Exactly. The last Moorish king. The last Moorish king of Europe. He was beheaded. Remember, Granada was the last stronghold. The battle of Los Naves de Tolosa. Las Naves, N-A-V-O-S, De Tolosa, T-O-L-O-S-A. That's the battle of 1212. While we were in fighting, Europeans were uniting their forces. They were funding night wars, Knights Templar, Knights of St. John's of Jerusalem, which is now called what? Knights of St. John's of Jerusalem, called the Knights of Malta now. We names, Knights of St. John Jerusalem, 1119. Knights of Malta, Knights of Rhodes. The Knight down the Knights of Malta. Alright? Knights of Calatrava. Order of Christ was 1338. Alright? So these orders were established to fight against us, because now their charge is to from 1095 to 1235. That is called the Crusades against the Moors. They were an all-right unity to regain control of Europe from the Moors. All right, that's a crusade against the Moors.
Right.
These knight orders were not charity orders. Right. They were orders to kick your butt. They were military orders coming strong, gain control to kick your butt. That's what their orders are today. Now, of course, we're not at war. Now, someone said to me, and I challenged them. I challenged them. Someone said, we at war. So, whoa. We just throw words out. We just throw statements out. We're not at war. We're prisoners of war.
Right, prisoners, right.
We're not. All
right. Right, exactly.
I don't see our brothers right in the streets shoot down Europeans. Like we are at war means this.
When we're at war, we killed them, they killed us. There was an organized military, you're talking about organization, military, war battle, horseback. All right, we're fighting them on horseback. That's at war. Now, are we doing that?
No.
No, no. Are we doing that?
Not like that.
We're not doing that. You said not like that. I don't know what that means. I don't know what like that, not like that.
It's an emotional, psychological war. And if we go claim our birthright, that's an active war, and they'll be trying to go off on us.
Brother, we're not at war, brother.
Okay, that kind of war.
To be at war, you have to be active in that war.
We're not active.
Right.
We're prisoners of war.
Prisoners of war, okay.
We're prisoners of war because our condition did not come about. You already know this. Our condition did not come about through being, and they're lying to us. 12 million of us were transported to the hell of the whole two ships. You know, right? And we think that's our history. We think our condition came about through 12 million of us, Portuguese and the French and the Dutch and the Hispanics and the English transported 12 million of us from the continent of Africa, you know, to the Americas. We think that's our history. We think our condition came about, no, our condition came about through war. They fought us, we fought them. The Battle of Los Nales de Tolosa, 1453. The Battle of 1453, the Battle of Lepanto of 1571. All right? The Battle of Malta, 1531. The wars and battles. We killed them, they killed us. We captured them, they captured us. Our condition today is a result of the loss. And we had infighting. So they didn't. The Ottoman Empire, you know, today they Germanized Ottoman to Ottoman. It's Ottoman, that's a family name. A dynasty is a ruling family. You have House of Tudor, House of Tudor, House of Hanover. That's just a family. Father, son, grandson, great-grandson, you know, that's a family. So a dynasty is a family. So the Ottoman dynasty took over, defeated the reigning Moorish dynasty. How did the Ottoman dynasty come into power? By defeating a reigning Moorish dynasty. So the Ottoman dynasty and Moorish dynasty were at war with each other. So we had that. They didn't come to our aid at Granada. I say we don't know the history. Because we think our history is not law. Brought along with 12 loads of ships, you know what I mean? 12 Chinese bench, you know, we think that's our history. We think our condition came into a condition as a result of that. No. These night wounds still exist right in front of your face. And you think they were established, they were not. Look at the history. Just research the history. That's all. Don't go by what I'm saying. You're gonna find what I'm saying. Because I'm doing what? Look it up. That's why. Those night orders were established as military orders with the purpose to fight against the Moors. And authors write it that way. They don't say blacks. Like the African bush crappers are saying. Europeans say Moors. They don't say blacks. But for some reason, these African scholars, not Europeans, African scholars say black. Not Europeans. African scholars say black. Not Europeans. Not Europeans. We book it by Europeans, that's all. We book it by Europeans. Most of them was Moors. Some say Muslims. But they ain't saying blacks. They're not saying blacks. You get that writing from African scholars. Get that. Linda Collin, she don't say blacks. Nafia Lampard, she don't say black. African scholars say that. Why are they saying that? Why did they say Moors? Why do they keep saying black? Where did black come from? Why did these African scholars? I thought they were scholars. I mean, I thought they were scholars, but they keep saying black. All right. So I just wanted to, you know, introduce this to y'all about the. All right, what I was saying, yes, that's what I was saying. This knowledge went underground. This is the purpose of this coding. I mean, this knowledge. Let's go back once again. The Moors, free flow of knowledge, free flow. You know what I mean? Free flow of knowledge. The Inquisition, the purpose of the Inquisition was to put a squash on what the Moors did. The Moors, free flow knowledge, Europeans, Inquisition, to kill that free flowing knowledge. And you were killed, literally. I'm walking down the street, and I'm no joke, walking down the street with a book in hand, they were killed. You were killed. You were killed! What they were doing was what? Reversing what the Moors did. So they went underground. Had them code this knowledge. It's preserved, but had them code it because you were killed. Some of you Europeans too. We're doing reversing what the Moors did, creating Moors took Europe from illiteracy to what? State of literacy. From a state of illiteracy to a state of what? Literacy. What the European, what they by Inquisition purpose is to what? Reverse that. They did it through torture. So remember, you got it. It's not the torture, it's not the torture, because you already literate. You know what I mean? You can't be made illiterate. You can't. Once you know how to read, once you can't, how can you be made illiterate? They gotta kill you. Once you know how to read, you are taught to read. They gotta kill you. And that's what they did. This is no joke. I mean, I gotta speak like this because this is the history, this is no joke. Torture you. Torture chambers and all that, stretching you out, you know what I mean? Cutting your toes off, and this is no joke. And guess what they guess in carnival? Carnival. What does carnival mean? Etymology. Carnival means carnage. Carnival. Corn. Why? Now the question is, why did they call it carnival? Because they were using flesh. They were using your toes and your fingers that they cut off. That's why it's called carnival. The history's ugly. It's ugly. You gotta face it. It's ugly.
You said they were using our flesh at the corner. Using our flesh for what?
All four games. Games. That's what I told you. Games, you know games and what? Yes. The history's ugly, bro.
Yeah, I just looked it up.
Flesh.
It's to remove
flesh.
Flesh,
literally.
The only pieces.
Like traveling and roadshow back then.
Right. Side shoulders.
It was always
up. Yeah, bro. See, because yes. They put torture chambers and everything, bro. Inquisition. Bro, the emphasis was no joke. They had to force illiteracy, bro. They reversed it. Because keep in mind, to have control of millions of people, you got to, they can't be literate. Alright, come on, hit me up, bro. Once again, what spurred the Protestant movement? Moors, what? Educating the people. Remember I said that there was illiteracy, higher illiteracy. Moors had, remember you talking about libraries and bookstores, over 600,000 manuscripts in the library of Cordova? So you talk about a wide spread of literacy, literature. Free flowing education throughout Europe. Cordova, Seville, and Toledo were the educated centers, not of Europe, of the entire world in that time period. 700, 800, 900,000 of the entire world. Moors controlled spice trade. The reason why the Moorish mill was the most powerful coin in the world because of the spice trade. We built wealth off by controlling trade. The Europeans, Vasco da Gama, Prince Henry the Navigator, they were members of the Order of Christ. Or the Order of Christ is the Knights Templar refashioned. Same order. They fought against the Moors. The Knights Templar are revealed in Portugal today. Why? Why the Knights Templar? Why can you? If you go to Portugal, you go to those souvenirs, spots, you see knights. Miniature knights, Templars. Why? Because they protected the, remember the Moors controlled Portugal for 500 years. Well, who defeated the Moors? The Knights Templar, the Order of Knights defeated the Moors. That's why they revered. See what I'm saying? Of course we wouldn't be revering them. But I can understand. I can understand their rebuilding. I can understand. Of course you would, because they kick your butt. Ain't like you can sell us like miniature knights or Templars in your store. You're not going to be rebuilding them because they kick your butt. But they're rebuilding them because they kicked our butts. That's how they gained control of Portugal. Because we don't know the history. Because we keep thinking it's somebody else. Some pale skin, whatever, somebody else. Because we think our history is, came from holes and shit, we all making them, we think that's our history. Man, history is invaluable, it's great, you know, but, you know, we looking for, came from holes and shit, we think our history. That's not our history, man. That's not our history, man. You know what I mean? I said we don't know our history. So, Europeans had a grave advantage. We had a disadvantage, man. Grave disadvantage. They got control of the institution. Give you this BS, false history. Lie to you, say that they established the war of the trades. When they start the textbooks, Christopher Columbus, 1492, Vasco da Gama, Prince Henry the Navigator, you know what I mean? No. The Order of Christ took over the spice trade from the Moors. They're lying to you in the textbooks. They did Marco Polo in 1200s. He went to India and he opened the trade routes. You mean for the Europeans? Praise the Marco Polo, 1204. There's a book called Medieval India under Muhammad rule. Medieval India under Muhammad rule from 712 to 1763. He ruled that port, Persia, modern day India for 1,000 years. And a lot of those words have been Arabized. He Arabized Persian words and Sanskrit words. He doesn't know the history. Questions.
All right, now, chapter one of my next upcoming book, The Masonic Conference Square, the Connection to Time, Masonic. The Masonic Conference Square, I'm going to slow it down. The Masonic Conference Square and their connection to timekeeping, to measurement and timekeeping. The Masonic Conference Square and their connection to measurement and timekeeping. That's the title of my next book. Should be in your hand July, late June, early July. All right, seven chapters. Chapter one, I go into this the night orders, why they were established, the year in which they were established, why they were established, what particular kingdom established that particular night order. All right? So, I even put some excerpts of Moors and Masonry in chapter one. I talk about this. I show that the eight-pointed cross that Knight Orders use is what this is. Tropical balls and the galactic balls intersection. I explain that. So I go into detail. I have lots of images. Loaded with images throughout the whole book. Chapter 7 deals with the astronomical portion of July 4th. And this, what I'm wearing around my neck, relates to July 4th. What am I wearing around my neck now? What's it called? Diameter, tau, it's a diameter. This is a niometer. All right, N-I-L-O-M-E-T-E-R, niometer. Niometer is used to measure the flood lines as the Nile River flooded. That was the key to the survival of the Nile Valley. When the Nile River flooded, if it didn't flood, because you have notches on the niometer, which tells you whether it would be famine or be a deluge too much. Either way, you're going to starve. All right? And that was predicted. You know, you would go, that the niometer is placed in a shaft along the Nile River, like a well, and dug all the way down, and there's winding staircases. And then you had the notches, and meticulous record keeping were kept, because it's for the survivors. This is what I'm wearing around my neck. This is tied to July 4th, because that July 4th is the hill of the rising of Sirius. So the calendar was based off of that, because they saw that astronomical phenomenon was key to their lifeline. Because that's what I'm wearing around my neck. So the Europeans do. Took your stuff, tell you something is worship. People bow down to it, wear it around their neck, wear it on their t-shirts, wear it on their hat, put on their cars, got on the buildings, they bow down to it. What did Dr. Pike say about it?
He says a lot, so.
I know, I'm talking about this, so. I know he says a lot, but about this. Oh, yeah, we got it. Yes. Any questions?
Yes. Again, I missed what you said about July 4th.
Now, yes. You've been taught that July 4th is a European holiday. You've been taught that it's the celebration of the independence of the Europeans from Great Britain. That's the first about what you've been taught about. That July 4th celebration is a celebration of, you know, the Europeans freed themselves from Great Britain. You know, that's their Independence Day celebration. That's what you were talking about. That's the first stuff about what you were talking about. July 4th is the Egyptian New Year. And that's tied Sirius cycles 365 days. The number 365 is tied to the cycle of Sirius. It's in the what's called the duat, or it can't be seen. It's behind the sun for a period of 70 days. That occurs around April, where it begins, when you can't see it, where it's invisible because it's behind the sun. That's called the, they call that the duat. 70 days. Now it can it reappears on July 4th. It's called the helical rising of Sirius. The helical rising of Sirius, where the sun, helical means pertaining to the sun, where the sun and Sirius are what they call in 0 degrees. It's called an conjunction, where there's 0 degrees of separation. So they're rising at the same time. We talk about how close they are in position. We talk about astronomy and also astrology. So it's 0 degrees of separation. When that occurs, the Nile River floods or rises. Because it brings about that rising. So a calendar was made, you know, because you're charting it. Because you got to chart it, you know, because you got to, because your whole survival is based off of that. And you have this diameter, because then you got, because you're measuring, like you know how people measure flood lines, you know, like the floods, and then they'll have a, put a plate here, you know, say 1912, all right? And they have right here, now another one, 1940, all right? You've seen this, and but they'll have like on news, and they'll have people's houses, they'll have a plate, indicating that's where the flood line was, all right? 1912, 1940, 1950, 1960, you know, the flood lines. Well, that's what the diameter. The diameter, there's notches on it. Don't worry about my neck. That's what this is. And meticulous records were kept. This ain't no joke when I'm wearing about my neck. It ain't nothing to worship. It's a measurement instrument. And our pipe says this, too. And it's both no morals or dogma. He only says it's European. He says it ain't European. Yup, so that's what that is. The colors, red, white, and blue, are your colors. That's your colors. Like I said, there's nothing European. So remember, let's start, there's nothing European. Even the name ain't theirs. So let me say I'll be on them, because they're not Europeans. I mean, they're not Europeans. That's a Moorish queen name.
Europa.
Their subjects are Queen Europa. They're not, only by virtue of their subjects, but that's not their pedigree. Mm-hmm. European is not their pedigree.
Right.
What is their pedigree?
Right.
I'll be honest.
Okay.
Well, they're amalgamated though. Remember, they still are. All right, so what is their pedigree? Moorish. Moorish is their pedigree. And I'm going to be truthful. Moorish is their pedigree. Let me explain. Because that's, you talk about their pedigree. You talk about now. All right. You are their pedigree. Right? The crossbreed, remember their father is the champ. Their mother is the Asiatic woman. Through in vitro fertilization, by fertilizing the egg with the sperm of the champ, through a process, process. They have like one, two. All right, but their pedigree would be the Moabite woman. I mean, that their mother. But they're not the firstborn. So now, all right, so that's the next, now explain now. Their pedigree is Moabite. That's their pedigree. They're not the firstborn. So they don't have the right to the birthright. They're not the primogenitor. They're not the firstborn. We are. All right, so I got to explain that way. But since you say that, because you asked me what their pedigree is.
I understand.
Their pedigree is Moor. All right? They're amalgamated Moors. They're not the firstborn. All right? Are you clear on what I'm saying, y'all? All right. Yes.
This experiment that took place, what's the name of it? Sorry.
The Yakubian experiment.
And real quick, going back to that Sirius discussion?
Yes. I'm not, I wasn't done with it.
Okay. But just for clarity, is that Sirius A or B?
Sirius A. So you got Sirius A, B, and C, and the Dogons taught it that thousands of years ago. Right. The fish, once again, that ain't your opinion. The fish, that go back to the Dogons. Thousands, they taught it that Sirius A, B, and C. See, your opinions are living off your virtue. They are standing on your syllables of accomplishment. So they're getting the credit for their lying. And they got these poor European children. Well, they're benefiting from the lie, so I can feel sorry for them. I mean, they're going to check them. Yeah, I can feel sorry for them. Because they're benefiting from the lie. All right? Got these European children who, you know, swear they did something. I mean, European children, they go to the museums and, yeah, man, the founding fathers and, yeah, the Greeks and, yeah, the Greeks developed mathematics and they see Europeans and, you know what I mean? And it's where these European children, it's where they came from, people that did something. You kidding me? And our children, yeah, we've been slaves, man. We ain't done jack. Okay? Now, this is real. This is real talk. Talk about the psychology. Let's address the psychology. You don't even know what they're doing. And that's implanted within us at a young age.
And they haven't even produced the ship's logs to prove. The slave ships. Because they can't. They can produce them for those of the Europeans that were transported here.
And many were.
But they can't produce them for transporting us.
Peter Wilson Coda. Immigrants in chains and immigrants in bondage. Immigrants in bondage is a list of 50,000. I got the book. 50,000 Europeans who were transported, who were bonded and chained. Remember, they were, when they were transported to chain. The Irish were packed like sardines and transported in chains from Ireland to colonies and also to Barbados.
Who was that, Peter?
Peter Wilson Coden, C-O, I got to say more than Matrix too, I listed it before. C-O-L-D-H-A-M, Coden. Yes.
What was the name of the book?
There are two books. Immigrants in Bondage, that's one book. And Immigrants in Chains, the another book. Peter Wilson Coden. So again, you got that transportation. So you're looking at 50,000, one number, then 20,000-30,000, another number. So you had that going on.
Right.
So you got ships that dealt with that. And they were arrested for what? For vagrancy. Thrown in jail, and they emptied the jails and shipped them off to the colonies. They were penal. They're penal colonies. Not work to the penal colonies. They have penal colonies. And, you know, Europeans weren't treated all great. I mean, you know, I'm not on this banner, but I'll put a banner of truth. So if Europeans weren't treated, they didn't even lie about. See, what they're doing in the textbook, see, they don't want to paint in the textbooks this harsh treatment of Europeans. But they're lying. They're lying in the textbooks.
Right.
They're lying.
It's still about the
Inquisition. Right. No. I'm talking about.
Oh.
But I'm talking about Europeans. In the textbooks,
right,
they paint that these Europeans, because they don't, in the textbooks, they don't write that they were bonded in chains.
plan, and it's dead.
That's
a selfish thing.
He's saying something. He's saying, great, brother.
I said, that's a self-esteem hit.
Thank you. That's the point. That's the point. I'm trying to get across.
Yeah.
Right? Because they're lying. You don't see that in textbooks. Peter Wilson called him, though, is not asked to write a chapter in the textbooks. Because Peter Wilson called him, wrote the chapter, or what about Michael Hoffman? Michael Hoffman is not asked by the chapter in the textbook. Because even Michael Hoffman and Peter Wilson called him, they get down. I mean, shoot, Europeans be looking, man, they be feeling, man, you talk about the self-esteem, it'll drop. Like you're saying, it'll drop because they get down. Imagine having European children in the schools. Reading about Europeans being bound in chains, chatting for it. You know, they don't read that. Once again, the self-esteem. But you read that about us. They were bound in the chains, man. They were transported in chains. They were hard labor. They're lying. They were not treated. This whole indenture here. See, we were slaves. And they were indentured servants by the lion. The lion. Mm-hmm. Once again, he said he did it. Self-esteem. Those Europeans were lied to. They were beyond the 7 years. Hard labor. Now, I'm not on this banner, but I'm on the banner of truth. Because, you know, the whole lie is, you know, I mean, they was indentured servitude, and they were treated and cuddled and you know, we whipped it. I'm saying to you, they were whipped too. They were brought transported in chains. They were, yes. But once again, the brother hit their head. They're not going to write that. They're not going to have people go some coding and Michael Hoffman and them like that. In the textbook. All right, so that's the key, the self-esteem. So what did our children mean?
When we met,
you know, Alan was saying, all right? Or you were being the same thing. Why don't you read that about the textbooks? Now, because I'm telling this truth, man, to use this great European love. Bam, I'm for truth, man. I'm for truth, man. You know what I mean? There's certain things that I know that other people don't know. All right? That's for truth. Moulay Ismael, Emperor Morocco, from 1757. To 1724. Whew, man. I feel sorry for European when I read the Bible. I'm serious, y'all. I feel sorry for European when I read about my.
One more time, what
do you mean? Moulay Ismael. Moulay, M-U-L-A-Y, and some spell it M-U-L-A-I. Ismael, I-S. M-A-E-L, Emperor Morocco, Iron Emperor, from 1757 to 1724, I believe. He reigned for 7 years. He is the grandson, he's the grandfather of our beloved Muhammed Ibn Abdullah, who signed the Treaty of Peace and Friendship. That's his father. That's his father. They love Muhammed Ibn Abdullah. No, you gotta understand history. And he's European love him, boy. I mean, you talking about a contract. His father cutting Europeans' heads off. I mean, him, you know, he recognizing Europeans in 1777, you know, offering protection bought the United States into the League of Nations in 1777. You know, in his father, 17 for 70 years, cutting Europeans' heads off. He's ruthless. Boom. Oh, yeah. Oh, they was, he was, I'm telling you, y'all. I'm telling you. I mean, they was a few. Yes. I mean, they, I'm sure that, man, you're Thomas Jefferson, though, man. They was wag for over him. I'm serious. I'm serious. It's just we don't know the history. When we think our history is, can't even hold the shit. You know, man, what about your opinion? Throw up in numbers. You know, they whipped them, we jumped off the ship. You know, me, like my ancestors, like the Black Panther.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd rather die and jump off the ships. Like my ancestors did. You know,
that one. Of course they did, right?
Yeah.
That's my man. Michael B. Jones, my man. Oh, man, bro. Come on, Michael. Yeah. So, questions? Yes.
Do you have any books on Sir Thomas Smith?
Sir Thomas Smith?
Smith with a Y.
Okay. Never talk to me,
though. He helped start the Virginia Company.
Oh, Sir Thomas Smith? I gotta do some research on him. All right. Do you have, have you heard anything about his fighting against the Moors or anything like that? I'm asking, I don't know.
No, he just came here early on when they first started to colonize, and he was basically awarded by historians as the start of the indentured servitude.
All right.
He's in White Cargo. He's mentioned in White Cargo.
Oh, he's in White Cargo. Yeah, yeah. White Cargo. That's another one. That Michael Hoffman, they were slaves of Michael Hoffman. That Peter Wilson called him. And who's the author of White Cargo?
I think it's two gentlemen.
It is two.
Two authors.
I think they're Europeans, too.
Yeah. I'm saying it's Europeans. Yeah. But
Don Jordan and Michael Wolf.
These two here, about over 100 of them. They're by Europeans. Mm-hmm. African scholars don't touch this. Because this is, I'm saying, this is their history. This is their history. Everybody by history. Because it's not in the textbook. Remember, they're not asked to write, chapters for the textbooks. You think they're going to have them write no text, chapters in the textbooks? So what they did was, in the textbooks, is make sure that nothing gets in regarding our interaction with them. Whether it's war or they paying us tribute or we sieging them and holding them in captivity. So that whole history is distorted. It's distorted. If you come up from textbook, man, I'm telling you, y'all, man, that stuff is weak and distorted, man. You cannot, that's why I give y'all a list of books to you. The issue of the Empire, y'all. They were white and they were slave, Michael Cole. White Harbor, you go on and on and on. You gotta read those books. I wrote Moors and Masonry. That list those books, reference those books. You gotta. Why do I have a different frame of mind? Because I read them, reading those books. And it gives you a different frame of reference. If you're reading textbook stuff, you don't know nothing. How are you going to use textbook stuff to analyze stuff? You can't. You got the war, you have the Battle of Alcatraz between Portugal and Morocco. What's that, 1581. The Battle of Lepanto, 1571. The fall of Constantinople, 1453. I mean, we can go on. Los Navas de Tolosa, 1212. I mean, this is our history. And yeah, pillars and masonry. Anyone know what they are? That's not me. Two silver pillars. I've talked about this before. The two silver pillars of Boaz,
Jochin.
Boaz, B-O-A-Z, Jochin, J-A-C-H-I-N. Those are two solar pillars. Europeans are preserving this ancient knowledge of marking the, charting the winter, the summer solstice sun, and the summer solstice sun is Boaz. The winter solstice sun is Jochin. You have these two pillars, Stonehenge, two pillars that marks the winter solstice and summer solstice sun. You have in Peru, Mexico, and other areas throughout South America, all right, an ancient site with two pillars and a boulder in the center, altar in the center, boulder in the center. So what the Europeans are doing, they're preserving this knowledge.
They're not sharing it.
Well, of course not. Here, why are you wearing those two pillars? What do you mean, why am I wearing my stuff? Why are you asking why am I wearing my stuff? Who are you? Who are you? Hold on. My question would be is, why are you wearing it? Why you got my stuff? I wouldn't say that to a brother, because that's his stuff too. So I'm not gonna say it to a brother. I mean, I would say it to a European. I'm not gonna say it to a brother. That's his stuff. This is my stuff. So I can't say that to a European. I mean, to a brother. I mean, that's his stuff. This is my stuff. Now, he may not know it's his stuff, but it is his too. Yeah, it ain't more mine than his. I mean, shucks.
These Masons, they take a oath not to tell those names.
Man, they don't know jack crap. Come on, brother.
But I mean, like those.
I hear you saying, Frank. I hear you, Frank. They don't know jack crap, and I'm not saying all.
All right.
Brother, let me say this, brother. Let me say this. When I did this lecture at the King Solomon Grand Lodge in Washington, D.C., 2013, July. I went on Sunday to TV because Sunetta asked me, Abdullah, why am I reaching out to Masons? What's your purpose of reaching out to Masons? I said to him that Masons have a network already in place, and that this information can move rapidly among tens of thousands of them. They have already a network in place that's been in place for decades. Guess what? When I put the paper out, and also I appeared on Sonata TV for an additional 4 or 5 times, Masons from all over the country were emailing me. Mm-hmm. Not to criticize me. Yeah. They didn't email me to criticize me. They emailed me to what? Get information. And these are brothers who have been alive for 20 years. Yeah. Grandmasters. Right. Yep. Yeah. Newton, Grandmaster. He said to me, Salah was here, because she was in office with him. She said, he was talking about this paper here, the second issue, the Masonic Eve. The 4th of July piece, the Masonic, Astronomical, Geometrical Origin of July 4th. Rastafari laid these out. Newbie said, man, he got it. He said, that was, because he said that this was the best one of all three. He said, he got it. Because he was learning from me. He 20 years deep, grandmaster and everything.
Yeah.
20 years deep.
Yeah.
They weren't calling me to criticize me. They didn't email me to criticize me. They were emailing me to congratulate me, thank me, wanted more. Can't wait to get the next one out. I ain't moving fast enough. You know what I mean? I'm serious, bro. I'm dead serious. And I was sitting there about 5 or 6 times. I would get calls from all over the country. Masons. Now, let me say this to you, brother.
If they knew all this that I'm talking about that I've shared tonight, you think they would be calling me and emailing me, waiting for the next issue, and I ain't moving fast enough? You think they'd be doing that, brother?
No.
All right.
No.
That's my experience. That's all I can only tell you my experience. That's all I can tell. I can't tell you about somebody else. I mean, I'm talking about me. Yes.
But, so, I don't want to speak. This is on camera, but.
Well, don't say it then. I'm smart, but you don't want to say it. I mean, you say you don't want to say it, but we're going to block talk too. So, this is block talk. So,
I know we
but if you don't want to say it, don't say it, though.
I know we need
it's up to you, fam.
Yeah. But it's out there. We got to do it. That's all.
Yeah, if you don't want to see the new camera, bro, don't say nothing. Don't say it. Yeah. Like, we ain't going to turn the camera off. I'm not going to turn the phone off. I'm not doing that. Just don't say it. Hey. Another comment. Right? So, all right. So, this knowledge is being preserved. You have Stonehenge. Same thing. It marks what we did was, we through observation, we would chart where the summer solstice sun would rise, and you know, and how it reflects. So we would mark, put a big pillar there. This is ancient. Same thing with the winter solstice sun. So we observed that the sun rises at its highest point of elevation, because these are two points where the sun is at an extreme, those are two extreme points. It's further northerly point, that's the summer solstice. It's furthest southerly point, that's the winter solstice. Now, the Masons celebrate the winter summer solstice, they call it the festival of St. John, but they celebrate on July, June 24th. But it's the celebration of the winter summer solstice. The most celebrated, St. John's Day is the most celebrated festival in all of Masonry, worldwide. What did they celebrate, Abdullah? The summer solstice. And they what? Had what's called the laying the cornerstone. Why are they laying the cornerstone, Abdullah? And where are they laying the cornerstone? In the northeast. Why northeast? Why northeast? You think the Masons know this, brother? You think all of them know this? They know the northeast. Then ask them why northeast. Because the summer solstice sun rises in the northeast. So they laid the cornerstone or keystone. They actually do that. They have this ritual. It's a ritual. You know, they decked up with your apron on, with your gloves on. Not there, but your gloves on, with your apron on. All right? And they all decked up with the top hat and everything, and up there, black shoes, and decked up and everything. You know, because it's a big thing. Everybody really saw. All right, of course they're not, brother, they don't give lessons like that the way I'm giving it like that. No, fam, no. I keep in mind, let's go back to the Inquisition. I would have been killed. Mm. They're serious.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Fam, if I was teaching this, they would have killed me, bro. No, Inquisition ain't no brother. Remember, I told you what they were trying to do. The purpose of the Inquisition was reverse what the Moors did. Right. This stuff had to go underground. Right. What truth is it? It had to. You were killed. What did they do with the women? Hunt them down, put them on trial. You know what I mean? Women knew, both European and Asiatic women, through planting, you know, herbs, and take this medicine, son. Mm-hmm. What they do to them? Hunted them down, had witch trials, and they what? Burned at the stake and put in hot boiling water. And the history's ugly, fam. It's ugly. It's called auto de fe. Auto A U T O D E E Fe F E. Acts of faith. So those killings of women and hung, you throw in boiling water, they call it auto de fe. The history's ugly. How did they gain their power? By defeating the Moors. Of course, we think we came on some ships somewhere. Or were transported by them on some ships somewhere. As long as we don't know our history, you're gonna keep saying European this, and English this, and Dutch this, and French this, BS. I don't know that. Y'all keep saying that, I ain't saying that. Moorish culture. You got the Moors, you got the Moorish bloodline all throughout Europe. European families with the Moors in the coat of arms. Right, so in my book, chapter 4, this is chapter 4 of my upcoming book. What I have is I show the calculation tables, the sunrise and sunset. Sunrise and sunset calculation tables. When I show what these are, now, from June 22nd to December 21st, the days get shorter. What I do in my book, every 10 days, every 7 days, I show you that there's a 10 to 12 minute increase or decrease. There's a 10 from June 22nd to December 21st. There is a 10 to 12 minute, every 7 days, a 10 to 12 minute decrease in the day. All right? What happens on this 21st? The sun dies. Jesus dies on the cross. The sun is at its lowest point of declination, so it can't go anymore. Harvest for 3 days. December 22nd, 2017, you see a plus 0.03. That means it's in 3 seconds. So there's a 3 second increase. Remember, it's negative. It's decrease, 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 decrease. So from December 21st, got a decrease, to December 22nd, 2017, there's a 3 second increase. Now we have the sun days are getting longer. And I show it in my book, every 7 days, there's a 10 to 12 day increase in the day. That's what those markers do. Malana Karana, my man. Malana Karana, my man. Christmas is our holiday, Malana Karana. Christmas is an astronomical phenomenon, Malana Karana. Christmas is the birth of the sun. Whether you celebrate her or not, she doesn't need you to celebrate her. Because it's been going on for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. She doesn't need you to celebrate her. It's intelligent that you mark her for your civilization. It's for timekeeping. It's intelligent that you mark the summer solstice and winter solstice points. It's intelligent for your civilization building to mark the birth of the sun. If you don't, it still won't occur anyway, because they don't need you to mark that.
Malala Karenga.
Malala Karenga don't need you to even recognize it. So why do you say, why do you need the Valpanza? When Christmas is a holiday. It's the birth of the sun. The Europeans co-opted it. Mithra, Zoroaster, Confucius, Krishna, Jesus, Haru, Dionysus, Apollo. Same story. Same crucified, same story. Same story. Jesus is crucified, or it's called the Sol Invictus, the day of the conquering sun. The sun, after dying, is those born of elevated detonation, is now what? Has overcome that. Sol Invictus. Saturnalia. Saturnalia. The sun. Entering what? Capricorn, which is ruled by Saturn. Break it down! Saturnalia! Come on, Malala Karenga. Walk with me, brother. Walk with me. And teach our people the truth about their holiday. Christmas. Walk with me, Malala Karenga, and take it back from the Europeans, Malala Karenga. Walk with me. I don't expect you to, because you're getting picked on millions and millions of dollars.
I don't expect you to do that, so
I understand.
You know, it'd be something if Malala Karenga gives a speech. Be like Abdullah Bay.
Yeah. Christmas is our holiday. How many people gonna walk out? How many people will walk out? Quite a few. Why? Like I did for 10 years. For 10 years didn't celebrate Christmas. And used Kwanzaa as a substitute for Christmas. And I lied to a lot of people. Like I was. A lot of people who do that. I'm not saying Malala Karenga, because I never heard him say that. But a lot of people do that.
See? See? I don't deal with Christmas. That's the white man's holiday. See? I'm African. And I deal with my African holiday, Kwanzaa. The white man holiday, that's Christmas.
Well, yes it is. You are the white man.
Okay.
So, it's true about that. Of course he's saying, of course they say, you know, they mean European. All right? So, even the suit that they wear, you call Santa Claus suit, that's yours. That's the shaman suit.
Right, shaman, right.
Yeah, the shaman, they want, you know, black boots. Red and white, that suit. That's the shaman suit. And they went out and what? When they entered the house, through what? The chimney. Oh, you thought that was made up. You thought that was made up? No, that's how they entered the house, through the chimney. And they went out and collected the red, white, the mascara, mushroom, red, white.
Right.
And the candy canes are symbolic of the red, white mushrooms. The red and white candy canes are symbolic of the red and white mushrooms. And it hung the mushrooms to dry. On the mantle, on the tree, right, to dry. And the mushrooms are highly mutagenic. So, of course, the reindeer you know,
Mobile.
Exactly. So they're floating. Exactly. It's not some made up, don't have no basis of truth story. Right. See what they're doing? It's based, it's, they're telling you truth there. But of course, you think it's just some story that somebody made up. What I'm saying, they present truth in front of you. What I'm saying, they're all lies. Well, they can do that because they already know they don't know the word of it anyway, so what difference does it make? All right? Now, there should be no European Santa Clauses. There shouldn't be. I should go to a European neighborhood and put on Santa Claus suit, Charlotte suit, and have a European children sit on my lap. I know that's not gonna happen, but because that's St. Maurice. St. Maurice was a philanthropist in Germany. St. Maurice was a philanthropist in Germany. He's a patron saint of all Germany. And he was dark as Wesley Snipes. And why they got the Europeans, you know, that's what I'm saying, they simply, and all that.
Is that Zwart Piet too, when they were the black woman? Like in like the Dutch man?
Yes.
That's the same person?
Yes, St. Maurice. Brother, St. Maurice was known. It's not some, he was a philanthropist.
Yes.
Brother, look it up. Look up St. Maurice. He's the patron saint of Germany.
Yes, he has many pictures with the suit. And had,
So why Europeans went, so there should be no European Santa Claus? Because right. That's a misrepresentation. They have European dressed up like Santa Claus is a misrepresentation. Of course, they're not going to have no. You go to their neighborhoods and have you sitting there, your children sitting on the ground. I understand that, but I'm bad. That still don't take away from what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And I know they're not, you know. But our children go sit on European laps. Huh? No, they don't. I say your child, say, what? Sister. They have European station at the malls. Now, they ain't all Europeans lined up either. Because I was lined up like my mom lined me up. So ain't all Europeans lined up either. We lied to being lined too. You know what I mean? But I'm saying we should be one of us. If we talk about truth, of course, they're not about that. I understand that. Because it's about, you know, it's about rulership, that they maybe can't pay the control. I understand that. All right? So I just, that's one of the real quick things in the proper perspective. So now we have here the Lion of Judah, the Lion of Judah. Now what is the Lion of Judah? Judah is son, that's you in. That's the IU, that's the Chaldean. IU is the IU, that's the Chaldean form of Jesus. The Chaldean form of the name Jesus. And then I have IES. Alright? It's IU. So Judah, so son and Leo. Son and Leo. So the line of Judah or the Paul. The sun in Leo that goes back 2,000 years ago, where the summer solstice sun in Leo. That was 2,000 years ago. So they have what's called the lion's paw. They're preserving this knowledge. The lion's paw. All right? That's what they're preserving. But they're not telling you, they're not going to break it down what I'm doing. They're just give you the imagery and, you know, give you these sayings here. All right, so when the Helical Riser Sirius rose over 2,000 years ago, It was when the summer solstice sun was in, when it's in Leo. And you have the Sphinx or Anu Keta, body of a lion and head of a man. It marks what? The point where the summer solstice and winter solstice sun were 2,000 years ago. What? And what? Summer solstice sun was what? Leo. Winter solstice? You're doing it again. Let's end it again. 2,000 years ago.
So it's going to be first?
Yeah, be first. Just do it again. Let's see if you got it. Capricorn now.
It's Capricorn now.
Look at my notes. I got it. All right. Let me read you. Let me cut the got
Aquarius.
Yeah, Aquarius. See, Aquarius. Let me go backwards. Aquarius, Capricorn, Sagittarius, Scorpio, all right, Libra, Virgo, all right, Leo, Gemini, you know, retrogression. All right, so the Sphinx represents those two markers 2,000 years ago.
Okay.
Head of a man, that's Aquarius, the water bearer, man pouring water. Body of a lion, all right? This European what? This European what? I didn't know. This Albion what? Culture?
Yeah, right.
Now, we talked about the crescent of the star, right? The pentagon, all right. Heavy metal groups, rock groups, they dressed in black. A lot of them dressed in black. A lot of teenagers, young adults, and heavy metal. They dressed in all black. Black lipstick, all right, all black. They have the five-pointed star, the pentagram, and the circle. And people think that they're evil and, you know what I mean, they're worship, devil worship, which is good. It's good that they're devil worship, all right? It's good that they're devil worship. But people, we already know that they think it's evil, you know that. All right? So now, let's talk about that. The black. Why the black? Why the five-pointed star? Why do they wear black? I'm not saying they all know this. Because they, remember, they're imitating. I mean, their friends are doing it. I mean, they grow up, they just imitate it. Their brother, older brother did it. Older sister, friend down the street. So they want to be like them, and they're in heavy metal. They're in hard rock, heavy metal. So they're going to wear all black. You know, they're gonna have the 500 star and the circle and, all right? So now, the 500 star, the pentagram, five cycles of Venus forms the pentagram. Venus cycles 584 days to revolve around the sun. 584 days, five revolutions around the sun forms the pentagram. Ain't got nothing to do with whether you, all right? It's just a natural progression. The black is tied to Capricorn. Saturn, what planet rules Capricorn? Saturn. No, now, sister, we're now. You took that 2,000 years ago, we're fine. She's correct. 2,000 years ago, she would be correct. No, you're doing a good job. 2,000 years ago, she would be correct. All right, but now talk about that.
Okay,
today. All right, got it. Let me tell you clear. What planet rules Capricorn? Well, remember, it was Aquarius 2,000 years ago. So
what is
Saturn? Right, it's Saturn. So, Capricorn is what? Give me the etymology. Capra. Goat. Horns. Goat horns. Goat horns. Goat horns. Goat horns. The word Capricorn means goat horns. Capra. That's goat. Corn.
horn.
Golden horn.
All right? So the heavy metal groups, rock, all rock, they wear black. This is your culture now, where they got people spooked up about it. They double, which is good to be a devil worshiper. All right, so, but what they did was, not them, not those children, not they, I'm not talking about them. They don't, you know, all of them know any better. Because they really think that they think they're trying to get in touch with some evil, whatever, and they're really not. They're not connected with no evil anything. It's been misrepresented like that. Hear me out, y'all. I want y'all to be, hopefully tonight y'all won't be scared of this anymore. It's being misrepresented. They're not trying to connect with no evil nothing. Not using this. You can't connect with no evil nothing using no horns. Because that's a sacred symbol. Woo! How you want to take a sacred symbol thousands of years ago? You can't connect with no evil nothing with that. They're misrepresenting it. I'm not saying these young people. But they don't know about it. Somebody told them, Europeans who were in control misrepresented that. I'm not talking about them young folks. They're young, you know. They're teenagers. They're 20. They don't know any better. Right? I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about the Europeans in heavy metal with hard rock. So the black is ties to Saturn. So you have the cult of the black world. The cult of the white world. Alright? The cult of the white world. That's what? The sun. The cult of the black bulls. That's Saturn. So you have this debate. Hear me out, y'all. This debate on what day is the Sabbath? Is it Sunday? Saturday. Or Saturday? Saturday. What is the origin of the debate? The origin of the debate is what calendar should we use? The solar only calendar or the lunar only calendar? That's the origin of the debate. Societies who use solar only calendars chart their what? Days by what? The phases of the Sabbath is what? Saturn. Saturday is the Sabbath. Not Sunday. That's the solar only calendar. The goat horns. The black. The coat of the black bulls. And the coat of the white bulls. Solar only calendar. Lunar only calendar. So those who are down with the solar only calendar, this, the lunar only calendar. They diss it. And they tell you that the word sin is an evil act. When it's a Sumerian name for the moon. They tell you that Friday the 13th is on what? Friday, Freya, on Old Norse. In Latin, Venetian, the day of Venus. 13 ties to the moon. So Friday the 13th is symbolic of the Venus and lunar calendars. What is the origin of the debate? So the black is Saturn. White, the sun. So the heavy metal, my heavy metal brothers and sisters, and I love them. Because they're making tattoos. Went to a tattoo convention 2016. And they're, it was at the convention center. And they're in their 20s. Most of the people, they were in their 20s. And there was hundreds of them. They're in their 20s. And I observed. I observed the type of artwork. And the artwork. I'm sorry, y'all. I took that call for those who are listening in Blog Talk. That's my glory. But I had to take that. So.
Yeah.
All right. So, yes, we have the black robes and the white robes. Judges wear black robes. Mm-hmm. All right. Saturn, that's stern, discipline, focus. All right. Saturn keeps you in check. So what they've done is they've misrepresented it. So I was talking about the tattoo convention. But tattoo convention, I observed these 20-year-olds, Europeans, and they're down with a pentagram and all right, and the horns and all right. So I know they don't know this like that, because they're doing it because their friends doing it. All right, they don't know this. I'm gonna like teach them this. All right, and tell them to continue doing it. Yeah, tell them to continue doing it. But once they understand that it's not some evil thing, see, that's the power is not that it's not evil thing. They're not connected with no evil in anything. But you talk about fertility. You talk about the gold ain't the symbol of fertility, power, woman. Not was, it ain't no was, that's what it is now. And it ain't no was. They're misrepresented. It ain't what they're saying it is. How is it that they can take something that's ancient and its meaning, its representation, and how we used it, and then tell you that it doesn't mean that now? Is that based in epistemology? How can I take something of yours that your society used for fertility, power, woman, regeneration, that you used for thousands of years? I take it and tell you it no longer means that. Who the hell am I? So this is the same, doesn't mean that now. But people, I think Europeans do that. Europeans are good for that. But I understand why that. Because to delve into their original meaning, they lose power. Their power is in the lie. I mean, they have the truth for themselves. Right? Let me qualify it. Their power is in the truth. But to maintain that, they have to what?
Keep it to
themselves. So their power is in keeping the truth to themselves and being shaping it to the public as something else. Let me qualify. I just wanted to qualify. All right. That's their power. So you start talking about ancient culture. If you start talking this, doesn't mean that now. We 2018, doesn't mean that now. You know, that's what it is. Because they don't want you to go here. I mean, they'll go here, but they don't want you to go here. Because what, you what? We lying to the power. That's why. They want you to see the snake as evil. They want you to see the devil as evil. The horns as evil. They want you black and pentagram as evil. They want you to continue doing that. I'll bow down to those things in a minute. Worship it, bow down and all that. I ain't bowing down to no man, nothing. I'll bow down to a woman. I'll bow down to a woman's statue all day long. I ain't bowing, trust me, brother, and I want you to really do this. If you see me bow down to any male, anything, I want you to take the nearest. Make sure it's hard. You take a baseball bat or a chair and knock me over by here. I want you to swing with all your might and knock me, and make sure you don't miss now. Aim by here, don't miss.
If you see me bowing out to any male anything, take a baseball bat, level, and don't miss my head, and make sure I don't get up. You crazy, I ain't bowing out to no male nothing. Ain't no power in that. Meanwhile, they bow down to the woman and tell and lying to the people and misrepresenting, yeah, the male. Yeah. Everybody in the world bow down to some male image. All in the world, male image. That's all you see. Male, 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 male. All right, now what about Venus? That Easter's ability about. In fact, that's a female name. I don't see no, I don't see them worshiping no females. Mm-hmm. But they're using a female name. Venus. Astarte. Ishtar. Easter. Esther. Ishtar. Astarte. It's Venus. So they're using the name. They're using the name. Easter. But they bow down to some male image. Ain't that something? How's that happen? All right? So this, once again, solar on the calendar, lunar on the calendar. So the debate, so you had those who were trying to state that the Sabbath is on Sunday. But the Sabbath can't be Sunday. Because that word is tied to a society that views the lunar on the calendar. Sabbath, seven. Sabbath. And that's what? What day of week is that?
Saturday.
Oh, thank you, sister. Saturday. Now, how's it Sunday? That's that political stuff again. All right, questions? Yes.
The goat, you stated, is sacred because it's for fertility.
Yes.
The same for the horn.
The horn. The reason why it was used is because of that. Because of the horns. The horn is shaped like a crescent. That's the only reason why we used it.
Okay.
Yeah. Because of the horn. It looks like what you see in the sky. The crescent shaped horn. Because when you can't see the new moon. You can't see the new moon. When you first see the moon, it's what? Shape of a crescent. You're not gonna see no new moon. If you see a new moon, but let me know, fam. Let me know you saw a new moon somehow. Please, but let me know.
It's the fallopian tubes.
All right?
Of the female.
No. I hear what you're saying, but I want to keep with the moon. I'm with you. I'm with you on that. I want to keep with the moon because we had calendar. I'm talking about this application of this knowledge. I'm about the application of it for civilization purposes, for agriculture. You talk about a calendar, a lunar-only calendar, where Mark taught the phases of the moon, and between each phase is 7 days. You talk about that was predominantly used in different parts, measurement. Then you also have the Venus calendar. You have what's called the Dresden Codex. Why it's called the Dresden Codex? Because the Europeans stole it out of Mexico and took it to Dresden, Germany. It's been since then, it's been in the World Museum since 1717. There's four surviving codexes out of 28 or 30, there are four surviving ones. Dresden is one. And the Dresden Kodak is a sophisticated compilation of Venus. 260 days, where it's the where it's the rising, what's called morning star, and 26 days later, it's the evening star. And that star again, remember, five cycles of Venus forms the pentagram. So when you see that, my brothers, my brothers and sisters, and you, Albion brothers and sisters, young brothers and sisters, who get down with the 500 star, that's good. You know what I mean? Let's worship that goat. You know what I mean? All right, now of course, they're not with me in knowledge, because you know, they just said it. All right, thank you, dog. Yes. All right, so the time has come to say goodbye to all my musketeers. Yeah. How do you think the class went, y'all? Yeah, so I'm back here on the third. I'm gonna say Friday again, Carmen. I'm gonna say Friday again, the third Wednesday.
Wednesday.
See, I do double the class, so that's the second Friday. Yeah, and Ross will be here, and Annie will be here on the second Wednesday. All right, so until next time, to get my book, Moors and Masonry, go to moorsandmasonry.org, moorsandmasonry.org. All right, thank you again.
What's the ECA on that next release? The next book coming up?
Fifth.
No, the next one you were talking about, where it talks about
when?
The
charges.
Yeah, that comes out. Oh, when it comes out?
Yeah.
End of June, early July. Yes, this year. Oh, this year. We already started the layout. We already started. Oh, yeah, we're rocking it.
Repeat that website you said that.
Moorsandmasonry.org. Yeah. The name of the book, .org. His brother? Thank you. Good. Thank you. Good. Yes. I'm sorry, guys. I looked at my phone and said, I'm done.
5 on the left, 2 on the right, repeat after me. Allah, Father of the Universe, Father of Love,
Truth,
Peace,
Freedom,
and Justice. Allah is my protector.
Allah is my protector.
And my guide.
And my guide.
And my salvation.
And my salvation.
By night.
By night.
And by day.
And by day.
Through his holy prophet.
Through his holy prophet.
Noble Drew Ali. Also known as Sheikh Sharif Abdullah.
For addition, Allah is the moon. The name Allah. It's Al-Uzza, the three names. Al-Uzza, Manat, and Allah. That's the name, that's moon. That's the moon. So, Allah, right outside. All right? Al-Uzza, Manat, outside.
I missed all of it.
Sin.
More than sand and the seashore, we're more than